Welcome. Thank you for joining us. We're glad you're here. You may have some memories or thoughts of what church is really all about. Is it a place to get married? A place you go when someone dies? A big potluck? Sometimes with that mystery dish. Bible stories on a flannel board? A place to sing hymns? It can be some of those things, but it's really learning to love God and to love others. Seeing our relationships with family and friends grow stronger. Serving our community. And a place to find hope in a world facing trouble. Also that we can share the incredible good news of Jesus with others who need this good news just like we do. We believe Jesus died on the cross and rose again to save us all, bringing us new life, healing, and peace. If it's been a while since you've been to church, or it's your very first time, or you're here every Sunday, no matter where you come from or where you've been, we welcome you to our church.
Yes, we welcome you to our church. Good morning, everyone. Good to see everyone. Thanks for stopping by to be with us for worship this morning. Welcome to everyone watching online as well. Let us stand as we lift our voices and get into worship this morning.
Praise is rising, eyes are turning to you. We turn to you. Hope is stirring, hearts are yearning for you. We long for you. 'Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. Washed away. Hosanna. Hosanna. God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna, come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. Washed away. Hosanna. Hosanna. You are the God who saves us. Worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna, come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus.
When we see you,
we find strength to face the day. Your presence, all our fears are washed away. Washed away.
Sin.
Hosanna, Hosanna. You are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna. Come on high among us, we welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Hosanna, Hosanna.
Seated, like you're following me. I have a couple announcements for you this morning. First of all, last week was Vacation Bible School, and if you weren't here, this place was turned upside down.
For Jesus, of course.
For Jesus, yeah. And it was really exciting. One night, I think their highest was 29 kids, but they had averaged maybe 24 or something like that, and it was a lot of fun. I was here one night with a boy, and this was his third VBS of the year, and so he was rating them, and we won, so, you know. So if you were a part of Bible school in some way, if you decorated or taught or came and helped or took pictures or something, will you stand up just for a second? Because it took a lot of people, and there are people that aren't here today. If you'll give them a hand. Thank you. I keep hearing stories about how a certain kid connected with a certain person and really loved this or that. So thank you for serving. The kids also did a great job. Out of those average of 24 kids, they brought in money, penny wars, to help buy some Bibles for Honduras. And those 24 kids in 4 days raised $210.44 to buy Bibles. So, kids, you did an awesome job. I hope you had fun. Second, our all-church picnic is July 30th. We're going to be at Cobus Park at noon. Denver and I think Wes are going to make some smoked pulled pork for us. They'll provide that. If you can bring a side dish and then bring your family's like paper products and bring your own drinks, and we will meet at Cobus Park at noon and just have a picnic. There's a playground for their kids, there's trails to walk, there's a volleyball net, maybe somebody can bring some cornhole and we'll just kind of hang out and fellowship together. And Fight Club kickoff. I should let you do that, you're right here.
Yeah, so August 26th, we are going to kick off our annual Fight Club 10-week discipleship program. For you men that have been a part of it, you know exactly what we're talking about, what we're ramping up. For those of you that have not ever been a part of Fight Club, come see me. Come see one of our guys. We'd love to share with you what the Lord does for those 10 weeks. But kickoff Friday night, 10 p.m., August 26th. I am ringing really loud. Thank you. So while I'm up here, are you done with your announcements?
No.
One more. Always waiting on you.
I think they wait on you a lot more often.
I thought she was going to turn my microphone off. I didn't know.
Just one last thing, just to mention this morning, that Pastor Sonia and Jason and Caleb are in Honduras this morning. Caleb and Jason planned on going on this trip. They couldn't go on the one with us, and Sonia just decided she was going to go again. So those of us who are left here are a little bit jealous, but we saw some pictures. They made it last night. They are there and ready to serve this week. So we're excited that the Holy Spirit is here with us, but I'm so grateful that we serve a God that He is there with them too. So just keep them in your prayers this week and remember them.
Amen, for sure. And so with us today visiting home for a couple of weeks is one of our missionaries, Chris Block. Chris, would you raise your hand? If you haven't seen Chris this morning, Chris serves an organization called Here to There, and they are a discipleship organization for students that are coming from overseas and are studying within the Houston area. And so Chris lives among them and ministers to them, witnesses to them, disciples to them, and incredible, incredible stories. So if you get a chance today before Chris makes it out of the building, stop him, ask him what the Lord's done recently. He's going to be with us a couple of weeks. Maybe we'll get another opportunity to spend some time with him. Why don't you stand? Let's go before the Lord in prayer, and we will get back into our music and worship. Lord, before time began, you were already in this moment. You're already speaking into the hearts of your people and creation. You were already working all things together for your good and glory. And God, quite honestly, you'd already declared victory over our sin. And so God, as we've made it to this moment, we're catching up to where you've already been. And so help us to walk knowing that you're here. You've been here. You know where we're going. Help us to have that boldness. And as we come before you and your throne and heaven in worship, help us to lay down the things that keep us from doing that well. Help us to let go of the things that are bothering us and troubling us and keeping us from really connecting to you. And Lord, to be quite frank, if there's anything in our lives that needs to be confessed, if there's any barrier between you and us that's sin, help us to get rid of that so that we have a perfect avenue to you. And then Lord, in a few moments when the Word of God is opened and we talk about progressive Christianity and how it's damning souls to hell, give us ears to hear it, hearts to understand it, and help us ask real questions about what we believe. Are we deceived in any way? And give us the courage, if we find the answer to be yes, to forsake it and to walk in a path of righteousness and truth. Bless those that are here for the first time, maybe first couple of times in a long time, those that have been away for some time. God, I just pray that you meet with us in a powerful way, that we would recognize your Spirit among us, and that we would be thankful and grateful and glad to be in the house of God. Bless now. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For he is good, he is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise. With a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, his love endures forever. And for the life that's been reborn, his love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Love endures forever, and by the grace of God, we will carry on. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Forever, oh, forever God is faithful, forever sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. God is faithful, oh, forever God is strong, forever God is with us, forever, forever.
God, we're so thankful this morning that you're with us forever. We know you're going to be with us today. You're going to be with us tomorrow and through the end of time. If only we just cling on and have a relationship with you this morning. We're just so thankful to be in the house of the Lord and be with you this morning. My foes are many, they rise against me, but I will hold my ground. I will not fear the war, I will not fear the storm. My help is on the way, my help is on the way. Oh my God, he will not delay. My refuge and strength always. I will not fear, his promise is true. My God will come through always, always. Trouble surrounds me, chaos abounding, my soul will rest in you. I will not fear the war, I will not fear the storm. My help is on the way, my help is on the way. Oh my God, my refuge and strength always. I will not fear, his promise is true. My God will come through always, I lift my eyes up, my help comes from the Lord. I lift my eyes up, my help comes from the Lord. I lift my eyes up, my help comes from the Lord.
I lift my eyes up. My help comes from the Lord. From you, Lord. Oh, my God, He will not delay. My refuge and strength always. I will not fear. His promise is true. My God will come through always, 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 always.
You may be seated.
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how He could love me, a sinner condemned unclean, singing how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song will ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. He took my sins and my sorrows, He made them His very own, and He bore the burden to Calvary and suffered and died alone, singing how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. And with the ransomed in glory, His face I at last shall see. It will be my joy through the ages to sing of His love for me, singing how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me.
Oh. All right, children, you may be dismissed. Hi, Irene. Bye, Irene. All right. Praise the Lord. Everybody wants backup artists, right? Is that the piano? We're going to take up an offering for the piano player. We are in week 9 and the final week of a sermon series called Believers. What I've tried to do over the past 9 weeks is show you the major world religions, their belief structure, their theology or belief about God, and why they're missing the mark. One of the concerns that I have as a pastor is I watch people leave a denomination and go to another denomination, and they base their church attendance only on the friendliness or the worship of that church, without really having much concern about what that church teaches or believes. And so not only within the Christian church, but we've seen over time people leave the Christian faith and go to Catholicism or go to Buddhism and go to, and they believe this lie that our culture has taught us. And many of you have heard it, and unfortunately some of you have said it. All it takes for salvation is sincerity. As long as you sincerely believe in what you believe, you'll be okay. My friends, that's not what the scripture teaches us. It feels good because it really releases us from any obligation of knowing the truth and then obeying the truth that we know. If all we have to be is sincere, well, we can be sincere. But some people, according to Matthew, will find themselves standing at the judgment seat of God as sincere as a human can be and be told by God himself that they are lost forever. And so my challenge to you is to hear the truth. And so we've talked about Mormonism. We've talked about Catholicism. We've talked about Jehovah's Witness. We've talked about Judaism. Last week we talked about modern Christianity. And modern Christianity might have all of the theology correct, but they just don't do anything with it. It doesn't change their life. This week we're going to talk about progressive Christianity. And progressive Christianity is probably one of the newest adaptations or mutations of the Christian faith. And I'll show you why that is in just a few moments. A man by the name of Lee Strobel. Lee was an atheist who went on a journey to try to find the truth about the Bible and God, thinking he was going to disprove it altogether. And in that process, found it to be true and was converted to Christianity and has become a great proponent for the faith. He writes this: "A friend took me and several others on a sailing trip through the British Virgin Islands. As a novice sailor, I was fascinated by the serious process of anchoring the boat at night. We would sail into a tranquil cove and drop the anchor. But in order to make doubly sure the anchor had a grip securely on the bottom, someone would dive into the water and inspect it. If the anchor were at all loose, it might fail during the night when we were asleep below deck and no one would know it. At first, this wouldn't be a problem because the boat would basically stay right where it was left if the anchor came loose. But over the long night, the gentle current and imperceptible waves would gradually cause the boat to float away, threatening to crash it against nearby rocks or ground it on the sandy beach. In Christianity, the anchor is sound biblical doctrine. And what happens if it's not secure or if its line is intentionally cut? Well, says philosopher Mark Middleberg, not much will happen at first. For a while, the faith wouldn't drift too far. Tradition and habit would keep it hovering over the same spiritual vicinity, at least for a season. But the real danger is what would inevitably happen over time. The current of the culture would cause Christianity to crash on the rocks of heresy and sink into irrelevancy. I want to sound an alarm this morning. This faith that is growing like wildfire right now is crashing against the rocks. And people are lost because of it. And the problem with it is not that they are in direct opposition to everything they've been taught, but it's the twisting of what they've been taught that's causing them to become lost. And this is why I've been spending weeks teaching these other religions, pointing out error, making a big deal over what many say is a small difference. Because the souls of people are on the line. And leaders and teachers and so-called preachers are cutting anchor lines, and we're adrift. There's a passage in the New Testament where Jesus is talking, and he's talking about a group of children that are around him, and he says something along the lines of, it would be better that a millstone would be tied around the neck and the person thrown into the sea than for that person to lead these little ones astray. And in progressive Christianity, I believe that's exactly what pastors and teachers are doing. They are leading people astray. But progressive Christianity is really difficult to spot, and I hope to show you why in just a little bit, but it's hard to know what speakers and what teachers and what pastors are progressive and which ones aren't. It's hard to know what their creed or their beliefs are because it's not necessarily written down anywhere just yet in full. One of the things that we've learned over time is progressive Christianity emphasizes action over belief. It's not as important what you believe as about what you do. They use much of the same vocabulary as historic Christians. They practice many of the same sacraments like baptism and communion. And they may even sing hymns and worship songs and recite ancient creeds and liturgies just like the Christian church does. So it makes it very difficult to figure out who's who and who's what. However, when you dig in and you start to get a real feel for progressive Christianity and some of the things they teach, you begin to find out that the words they're using, though identical to the words you would hear in a good biblical-based Christian church, are the same words but have different meanings. The phrases, the sacraments, and the traditions below the surface have taken on a whole different meaning. That's why it's so confusing. That's why it's hard to identify them. Sometimes we'll find a book and you're so engrossed in this book because it just seems so fresh and it seems so new and so good, only to find out when you really try to understand what you're reading, wait, this is not the Christian faith whatsoever. The same with blogs. You read these blogs or you listen to these podcasts or you hear these sermons and people are sharing them and posting them and reposting them and retweeting them, and it seems great and wonderful. When you dig just a little bit deeper, you realize this is not the truth. It feeds our desire. It makes it feel like we finally found the piece that is missing. But it's hell. And it's damnation wrapped up in Christianese. However, as hard as it is to figure out who's who and what's what, there are some very concrete beliefs that are out there that are titled progressive Christianity. And in this day and age, they're not afraid to say that they are progressive Christians. And so you kind of track them down and you start to understand and read what they believe. And that's what I want to share with you today. Again, this whole sermon series, I have made the promise to you that I will use their quotes, their books, their writings, their doctrines, and I will read them to you and compare them to what we know to be true. Today will be no different. So let's talk about progressive Christianity. It's a new term, and not many people are familiar with it, and it actually goes back to 2006, and it was birthed into the Christian world under a different name. It was actually birthed by the title The Emergent Church. And some of you may be aware of that. If you were up on your Christian lingo at the time and you were following all things Christian and church, you might have heard The Emergent Church in around 2006, to 2010. Now, the heart of these movements was the desire to articulate a way of being Christian that was an alternative to the Christian faith portrayed in the public realm. What do I mean by that? Well, the progressive Christians of the day, 2006, were really kind of have grown weary of defining the Christian faith in negative terms. And out of that gets the phrase, it's not what the church is against, but what the church is for that we should be talking about. And I think that's pretty good. I one time and still to this day believe that the church should be preaching and teaching about what it's for, not just what it's against. Many of you, if you're older than me or my age, you probably grew up in a church that had the laundry list of all the things you don't do. You don't smoke, cuss, or chew, or go with girls who do. And your whole church, no, never heard that before? Your whole church and belief system was about the things you don't do. And progressive Christians in the emergent church said, we're really tired of being identified against with negative things. Let's identify ourselves with things that we're for. And so this emergent church kind of got some ground and got some steam behind them because they were starting to speak some things that really resonated with the soul of modern man. But it went quickly off the rails. From their website, progressivechristianity.com, I quote, "We aren't fundamentalists. We don't believe the Bible is the inerrant or infallible word of God. We don't agree that creationism should replace the science of evolution in public schools. We don't believe that God hates gays. We don't believe the people of faith or that people of other faiths are going to hell unless they convert to Christianity. We don't deny the right of women to choose what happens to their bodies," end quote. And so they found within Christianity these negatives and said, we're not about the negatives. We want to be about the positives. And so while that seems right and it speaks to us with inclusivity, all of a sudden you come into this headlock with scripture and truth and a theology of God. And some of the things that you're trying to be inclusive are against the word of God, so then something has to give. Unfortunately, in progressive Christianity, the Bible was the one that had to go. I'll show you what I mean. Progressive Christianity has really become a church of cultural acceptance. In early 2019, progressive Lutheran minister Nadia Boltz-Weber wrote a book about sexuality called Shameless. Shameless, a sexual reformation. In it, she argued that the idea that sex should be between one man and one woman within the covenant of a marriage for life was not just incorrect, but harmful to humanity. She recommended reinventing the Christian sexual ethic to allow Christians to pursue sexual fulfillment as defined by the WHO, or World Health Organization. Think about that for a moment. Christian pastor said the government should decide what sexual fulfillment looks like. She says it should be grounded in consent and mutuality and not much more. So two people who consent, all that's required for a healthy sex life. With the biblical boundaries for sex removed, she continues and writes, "Whatever sexual flourishing looks like for you, that's what I would love to see happen in your life," on page 60. So with this redefinition of sexual flourishing, Boltz-Weber approves of sex outside of marriage, one-night stands, homosexual sex, and moderate use of pornography. Lutheran pastor. And she isn't a lone voice in that wilderness. Shameless was endorsed and promoted by many other prominent progressive Christian leaders and pastors, such as Rachel Held Evans, Glennon Doyle, Sarah Bessie, Richard Rohr, and Austin Channing Brown. With prominent progressive Christian personalities like Jen Hatmaker, Sarah Bessie, Rob Bell, Jim Wallis, all speaking out in favor of same-sex marriage within the last couple of decades, one of the key goals of progressive Christianity is to change the church's mind on this hot-button issue. Jen Hatmaker is all the rage right now on social media because of the article she wrote on how the Christian church needs to accept homosexual marriage and sex. It's a church of cultural acceptance. So then it begs the question, so then what do they really believe about the Bible? Because even as I'm saying that to you, you're feeling the tension in that is not what I taught was taught that the Bible said. So then what do they believe about the Bible? Someone once said within the progressive Christian church that the Bible is a record of what people believed about God in the times and places in which they lived rather than the inspired and authoritative Word of God. So it's what these men and what these women believed in the time and place in which they lived thousands of years ago, and it's not relevant today. It's not uncommon for progressive Christians to express disagreement with a biblical writer or to reject the passages that they find unhelpful to humanity. In fact, progressive leader Richard Rohr encourages Christians to ignore, deny, and even openly oppose scripture that are, I quote, imperialistic, punitive, exclusionary, or tribal. In progressivechristianity.com, they have what's called the Phoenix Affirmations. In Phoenix Affirmation number 2, I quote, "We confess that we have moved away from Christ's path when we have claimed that God's word is restricted to that which may be contained within a written document, or that either the recording of God's word in scripture or our interpretation of it are infallible." We have moved away from Christ's path when we claim that the Bible is infallible. So what do they believe about the Bible? They think, like many other world religions, it's a good book, but it is not the divine, inspired, inerrant Word of God. Well, when you discard divine, inerrant Word of God, then it's easy to read anything into it, anything out of it, and reject it wholly. Because if it's not really God's words and it's not really infallible, if it has errors in it, then anything you don't like, you don't have to follow. Well, it really kind of leads into the next question then. Okay, if that's what they believe about the Bible, then what do they believe about the God of the Bible? Because really that's the way we understand Scripture, that the Bible is God's way of revealing himself to humanity. You want to understand God? Then understand the God of the Bible. So what do they believe about God? Someone once said that progressive Christianity is really just a church where theology doesn't seem to matter. Theology is a Christian word. It means the study of God or the understanding of God. And within the progressive Christian church, the understanding of God really isn't that important. I believe theology matters because theology dictates action. If you believe something about God, that's going to motivate you and move you. But if what you believe about God is wrong, then your motive and action will be wrong. In addition to that, one's theology also reveals the true source of authority. And so if the Bible is not inerrant, and the Bible doesn't really speak truly of who God is, then the Bible has no authority. And it's a really short step from there to say that God has no authority. Because now we don't have a truth about God, and God can be anything that we want him to be, and we can't find it to be true or false because there's no other document to prove it. So therefore, God loses his authority. So now we're left to decide what's right for ourselves. And in our modern culture, we hear the phrase, truth is relative. Speak your truth. Live out your truth. And I can't tell you what your truth is. I can only tell you what my truth is. Listen to me. No, there is truth. And it is absolute. It is measurable. And it is finite. And Jesus says, he is the truth. You say, well, Christians are exclusive. Yes, we are. By God's design, not mine. God said about his son that he would be the way, he would be the truth, and he would be the life, and no one would come to God except through Jesus. You say, well, I don't believe that because I don't believe the Bible. You don't have to believe in gravity. I promise you, you jump out of a plane, the truth of gravity will show you its truth. And there's going to come a day where you will stand before God, believe it or not. And God will call you to an account for what you did with the blood of his son. Well, I don't believe in the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. You don't have to believe it. There'll be a lot of people that didn't believe it that'll still have to account for it. Richard Rohr, a progressive Christian author and speaker, says, God's wrath is theologically impossible. So Richard Rohr has figured out, based on what his understanding of God is, that it is impossible, theologically impossible, for God to have wrath. His study of God leads him to believe that God's wrath is not possible, not because of the scriptures that he studied and found, but because of the people he has met and talked to. His feelings tell him that God could not allow someone to be damned to hell, so then therefore it must not be true. We hear that. We hear people say, well, I can't serve a God who would send someone to hell. And we kind of poke around in that because we know and believe God doesn't send anyone to hell. We send ourselves to hell. God allows it. But God doesn't send anyone to hell. God's not up in heaven sorting people out. I like this one. I don't like that one. I like this one. I might like this one if it would change a little bit, but I'll put him over here until he changes. Right? That's not who God is. But when you don't understand Scripture, when you don't have authority within the Scripture, when you don't understand the God of Scripture, then you're left to your feelings, and your feeling says, it feels like that's what God's doing. And if that's what God's doing, I want no part of it. So therefore, I can't believe a God that does that, and I don't want to throw away God, so then I recreate God. And I create him to be the God that I want him to be. And my God is nice. My God is loving. My God will not send anyone to hell. Rob Bell is why he fell off the face of Christianity, because he could not, within his soul, understand and believe that God would send people to hell. So he recreated God. And so he took on for a season nihilism. And it was the idea that, okay, they're still going to go to hell, but God's not going to leave them there eternally. After a season, a very short season, God will just annihilate them as if they never existed, so they don't have to be punished eternally. And all of a sudden, it puts God back into the favor of man. Now I can worship that God, because at least that God has morals. In progressive circles, the idea that God would require the blood sacrifice of his only son makes God the Father out to be some kind of divine child abuser. And so many progressive Christian churches are denying substitutionary atonement. Right, so we have this sin, and it's this debt we're building up because of these choices that we're making to be offensive and to miss the mark and to go against our Creator. And so as this list of sin builds up in our life, it has to be atoned. It has to be paid for. And so God saw in us the inability to pay for our sin, so he sent his son to die on the cross to pay for our sins for us. Substitutionary atonement. He went in our place, substitutionary, paid for our sins, atonement, substitutionary atonement. Progressive Christians say that did not happen. Michael Gunger, the musician and host of the Liturgists podcast, wrote, I would love to hear more artists who sing to God and fewer who include a father murdering a son in that endeavor. He goes on to say that God needed to be appeased with blood is horrific, and I cannot stand it. So the Bible has no authority. God has no wrath. Well, then what do they believe about Jesus? A few years ago, a popular progressive blogger, Unfundamentalist Parenting, published a post written by progressive children's pastor Anna Skates titled, How Not to Talk to Your Kids About Easter. Still up on the website, still track it down, you can still read it in its entirety. In the article, she wrote, and I quote, the reality is Jesus didn't die specifically for your kid. I know that's a bit blunt, but technically, Jesus died publicly and grotesquely because he was a political and religious threat to those in power. End point. She goes on to say, the point of Easter story isn't whether or not Jesus literally rose from the dead. We're missing the point if we're fighting over the historical accuracy of a bodily resurrection. She goes on to advise parents to tell their kids, quote, stories don't have to be factual to speak truth, end quote. And the whole gist of the article is that that Christ didn't die for our sins. Christ died because he was opposing political leaders. And he doesn't have to literally rise from the dead to have some truth to the story. And so we shouldn't be teaching our kids that he died for our sins and that he literally rose from the dead. Now, wait a minute. Our whole faith is based on that event. See, sometimes we get sidetracked and we think that our whole faith is based on a book, but it's not. Our whole faith is based on an event. If Jesus didn't die, get buried, and resurrect from the dead, we don't have a faith. We have a country club. If we remove the resurrection of Christ from the dead, we should just go home. Alyssa Childers writes, "The truth of Christianity stands or falls based on the resurrection of Jesus being an actual historical event. Scripture tells us that if it didn't happen, then we have no hope for salvation beyond this life." Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 14, you know, if you can believe anything Paul says, "If Christ has not been raised, our preaching is in vain, and so is our faith." Verse 17, "And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile and you are still in your sin." But again, it's this idea that we want to be culturally relevant and inclusive, and the culture demands things, and the emergent church said, we don't want to be known for what we're against. We want to be known for what we're for, and we're for the culture. So therefore, in order to be for the culture, they have to twist the Bible, they have to twist the theology of God, they have to twist the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Because if those three things stand, they cannot be culturally inclusive. What do they believe about sin? Progressive Christians generally reject the doctrine of original sin. Wait a minute, stop. Original sin is off the table too? The doctrine of original sin said that because Adam and Eve sinned, sin became part of the human DNA, so to speak. Romans tells us that because one man sinned, death was given to that man, and so death passed upon all men. It's almost like we inherit sin and death. It's the doctrine that says we're born broken. We're born bad. And we argue that with evidence. No one had to teach your child how to lie. No one had to teach your child how to manipulate. They come out of the womb doing that. They know instinctively, if I cry, I get what I want. If I don't like what I get, I keep crying, I get what, right? That's manipulation. You say, well, that's not sin. No, it's not sin, not at that point, because they haven't been taught that that's wrong. But they come out of the womb doing wrong things and lying and cheating and stealing from their brothers and sisters, and stealing from their parents, and they're selfish. Those aren't good traits. That's not what we want our kids to grow up. I want my kid to grow up and be selfish and a thief, and to really make things great, liar on top. No, those are the things we try to teach out of our children. But we're born with sin. And so we get to the age of accountability where we begin to understand what is right and what is wrong and the ability to be able to choose between the two. Now they have to understand that that sin is causing them a problem that is eternal. And they must do something about it. They must atone. That's original sin. Progressive Christianity rejects that and calls it original blessing or original goodness. That we're not born in sin, we are born good. And over time we choose sin. That we're not inherently sinful. We're not depraved. We're good. We're not separated from God by sin. And so then because of that, Jesus' death becomes more of a moral example of how to live rather than the actual solution for the sin we were born in. I'm going to get a little bit deep. Maybe not for some of you. For others of you, it's going to go over your head. But there's a lot of teaching and a lot of theology within the Word of God when it comes to substitutionary atonement. Like, that's a big piece of our faith. And so there are things that are called theories. I want to point out three of them that when you combine them together, you get a total picture, almost a total picture of what substitutionary atonement really is. Because it's not as simple as I've described it to you today. It begins with the Christus Victor theory. The Christus Victor theory helps us to understand that Jesus came to defeat the power of sin and the power of death and the power of devil. Right? We know that because he overcame death, that we can overcome death. We know that in the time while he was in the grave, that he enters and he takes the keys from the gates of hell away from Satan so that we can have victory over that eternal death. And we know that through his death, burial, and resurrection, that he's defeated our foe, the devil, and therefore we live in victory. So that's a piece of substitutionary atonement. Then there's the moral influence theory. And this gives us Christ, the Son of God, as an example of love and forgiveness that we should follow. We see that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. And so therefore, because God loved us, we love him back and we love others. It's the golden rule. It's the rule that Christ said, there's one rule that's above all and there's a second that's just like it. Love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, soul, and mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. It's an example that Christ gave us. And then we are told to forgive, even as Christ forgave us. That's a moral influence theory. And then the final theory that kind of wraps up this picture of substitutionary atonement is called penal substitutionary atonement theory. Notice the word I added, penal. It means punishment, punitive. It illustrates how Jesus took the punishment of our sins upon himself and satisfied the wrath of God. He was punished for us. He didn't just die for us. He was punished for us. The wrath of God was upon him. It was punitive because that wrath was going to be upon us. And so with Christus Victor and the moral influence and now penal substitutionary atonement, we kind of get a bigger picture that the salvation that we experience and will have hope for until the day we die and meet God and are received into our eternal glory is much larger than Jesus died because he loves me. Yes, he did. He died because he loves me, but he also died because the wrath of God had to be satisfied. He died because there was some morality that had to be assuaged. We had to figure it out. We had to understand that we cannot live to satisfy our flesh, to satisfy our desires, and do whatever we think is right. There is an absolute truth, and we must adhere to it. But our culture and our society says there is no truth, it is relative. And this church, this progressive Christianity, so desires to be inclusive and to say everything is okay that they throw out the very thing that actually makes us okay. And so they live their 70 years on earth feeling pretty good about themselves, only to die and go straight to hell. Because they believed in self. Not in God. In progressive circles, the idea that God would require the blood sacrifice of his son only makes God the Father out to be some kind of divine child abuser. Therefore, they deny the penal substitutionary atonement of Christ. Someone once said that progressive Christianity can be best understood by this story. Two children, noticing flames and fire in the basement, started shouting loud to their mother, "Mom, Mom, the house is on fire, the house is on fire." And the mother scolded the children, "Be quiet, your father's upstairs asleep." For a very temporary gain, they throw away their eternal life. In an effort to be inclusionary, they rub out all things in Christianity that makes them feel that Christianity is exclusionary. But what they miss is the truth will offend, and it is exclusionary, and it is a stumbling block. 1 Peter 2:7 says, "So the honor is for you who believe, but for those who do not believe, the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone, and a stone of stumbling, and a rock of offense. They stumble because they disobey the word as they were destined to do." Well, I don't think following Jesus should be hard. I don't think following Jesus should mean some people are left outside and in the cold. It's exactly the way God said it would be. 1 Corinthians 1, verse 18, for the word of the cross is folly to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. Paul is telling the church in Corinth, it seems utterly ridiculous that you'd have to accept Jesus Christ in order to go to heaven, and all other faiths are damned if they do not. Yeah, it sure does. But it doesn't negate that it's the truth. Galatians chapter 5, verse 11, but if I, brothers, still preach circumcision, why am I still being persecuted? In that case, the offense of the cross has been removed. It is offensive. It is offensive. And Jesus Christ himself was offensive. And people rejected him and turned away from him, followed him for a season, and walked away from him. Even Jesus Christ himself winnowed out unbelievers. We were told this would happen. Jesus himself said, watch out for false prophets. They come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ferocious wolves. They're going to look like us, they're going to talk like us, but on the inside they are not like us. He not only predicted that Christians would be tempted by these false doctrines and pointed out that these teachings would be peddled by people who claim to be Christians, but that they would look like sheep, walk like sheep, and talk like sheep. But they are not sheep. They are predators. And they are devouring innocent people. And so as you go along in your Christian life, you're going to bump into some things that are going to really feel better than maybe what you've been taught. And the idea of inclusivity and allowing you to make some choices even though the Bible says it's wrong, or including people that can live an affirming lifestyle among you and never be called to repentance, never be called to confess their sin, never be called to account for who God really is, and they live their life the way they want to but want to be part of a church while they do it. And it seems right, and it seems loving, but listen to me, just like those kids in the basement who are being told to shut up because their dad's sleeping, that is not love. That's fear. And the reason we're bending so much and changing so much of what we know to be true is because we're afraid that we might be rejected by the culture, that somebody might get mad at us. Somebody might get on social media and say bad things about us and our church or our pastor or our Bible or our God. Listen to me. They don't need to be defended. The church will stand against the gates of hell. God's already taken care of that. I don't need to be defended. God does not need to be defended. If they get upset with who God is, that's on them. Do we love them? Yes. Do we bend over backwards to try to show them the love of the Father? Yes. But do we change right so that they can be affirmed? No. No. So be careful that you don't take the bait and you just believe it because it affirms within you what you want to be true. You better make sure that the reason you do and say and teach and believe the things that you do, say, teach, and believe are because they came from the Scripture, and that they came from God, and that they support what the Bible says about your salvation. Otherwise, you're damning yourself to hell. And so you get to live your 70 years affirmed by the culture in which you live, but you will face God. You will face God. It's really difficult in this day and age to ask you to stand against the culture. But if you can just for a moment understand just how brief this life is compared to your eternity. God gave you this time so that you could be witness to, receive, and live in relationship with him on earth so that you could have eternity with him. Someone once said about life on earth is just the introductory to the real book that's to come. And we've got it all backwards. We think this is the book. We think this life is what it's all about. No, it's not. This is the introductory. This is the preface of what's really going to be the story. And the story is going to be our life in eternity with God and Jesus Christ. And you live your life for your flesh here, you're going to regret missing the story. Jesus said, if you're going to follow me, you're going to have to deny yourself. And you're going to have to be willing to be hated by the world. Some days I'm okay with that. Some days I'm not. Some days I care about what people say. Some days I don't. But the truth of the matter is everything I say and do, everything that you say and do is an audience of one, God himself. If at the end of every night when I lay my head on my pillow, God is happy with me, I should be happy. But if you get the whole world to be your friend because you're willing to affirm anything and everything, and yet God says to you, I never knew you, depart from me into eternal damnation, what did you really get? Of course, there's so much more. We didn't talk about what they believe about heaven or hell. We didn't talk about what they believe about the Holy Spirit power. We didn't talk about so many things, but I hope with just those four things that you can understand this is straight out of hell. It's straight out of hell. This is Satan's way of destroying you. Heavenly Father, that is a lot. Oh. And some of us have never really gone that far into theology or the doctrine of substitutionary atonement or the doctrine of the inerrant word of God. We just go to church because it feels right and we like those people and we like to worship. But God, it's those foundational truths that make us Christian. It's those foundational truths that allow us to receive forgiveness for our sin. It's those truths that assuage your wrath and allow us to walk in relationship as righteous. God, help us to care about that. Help us to even begin to understand those things so that we're not easily deceived and beguiled, carried away by the next crafty thing that we read or hear. And help us to be willing to stand against the culture. For your sake. For your glory. So that our witness stays true. Our witness stays right. And so that our words have effect and power. Help us not to be dictated to by another human being, but help us to be led by your word and your Holy Spirit and our beliefs about who you are. Lord, whoever's in the room this morning, you know better than I do. I just pray that your Holy Spirit would speak. If there's anyone here that's believing a false gospel, if there's anyone here who's holding on to cultural relevance or inclusivity, if there's anyone here who's willing to throw away Christ so that they can adapt or affirm or receive the world, I just pray that you'd speak to them. That today would be the day that they would recognize truth in its purest form. In his name, Jesus Christ. Bless us now. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. Church, would you stand? Would you take some time as we sing to think through what it is that you really believe that's going to get you to heaven and into that relationship with the God that created you?
You hear me when I call. You are my morning song. Though darkness fills the night, it cannot hide the light. Whom shall I fear? You crush the enemy underneath my feet. You are my sword and shield, though troubles linger still. Whom shall I fear? I know who goes before me.
I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side.
My strength is in your name, for you alone can save. You will deliver me, yours is the victory. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I fear? I know who goes before me. I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side.
The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. And nothing formed against me shall stand.
I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side.
The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. I know who goes before me. I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side.
The God of angel armies is always by my side.
Well, while they still allow me to have a microphone and you are still in this room, let me clarify with you what I did not just say to you. Because it's real easy for you to leave this place and say, okay, here's what I think I heard him say. And then it becomes fact. That's what I said. Here's what I did not say. I did not say God hates gay people. I did not say that if you believe in abortion that God hates you. I did not say that they cannot attend this church and that if you're in sin, that God is somehow looking to squash you with his thumb. I did not say that we don't love those people. I did not say that they're not welcome. I did not say that we're to treat people poorly because they're sinners. You know why I don't believe that? Because you're sinners. I'm sinners. Here's what I did say. You cannot have a relationship with God and his son Jesus Christ if you are not willing to deal with sin. God calls us through that relationship to repentance. And if you live your whole life saying you have a relationship with God, but you never deal with your sin, I would say to you, based on what I know about God and the Bible, you don't have a relationship with God. And I know well-meaning, good people that believe in God, but will never, ever deal with their sin. And they just want someone to say, it's okay, it's okay, it's okay. And so they go to churches that affirm their sin, thinking that means it's okay. It's not okay. Just because someone says it is not the ticket you're looking for. So I didn't say we hate anyone. We don't. Anyone and everyone are welcome in this church. And that's a pretty important statement because we're starting to get a barrage of messages and emails and DMs from people that say, what do you believe about? And they fill in today's hot topic. Tell us what your church stands for. Tell us what you believe. We know full well if we answer them, it's going to cause offense and it's going to cause backlash. So our comment to them is, come Sunday morning, 10:30, everyone's welcome. And it's true. You are. And they are. And they can worship with us, and I will befriend them, and I'll take them out to lunch, and I will do everything in my power to win them to Jesus Christ. But I know this, they will have to be confronted by the Holy Spirit and their sin, just like I did, just like you did. So don't misinterpret what was said this morning. We're not hating anyone. I love you enough to tell you the truth. And the truth is that God is a God of love, and a God is a God who requires repentance. God bless you, church. Have a great week. We'll see you next time.
But real quick.
Sorry.
Sorry, I've got a quick announcement, too. So for a $20 finder's fee, we have a key to someone's Hyundai here. Oh, Joy Dean's already waving her hand. So
I have another announcement. There was a ring that was found out by the trash cans. If you're missing a ring, come see me.